for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Mrs. Hamel, would you do the roll call, please?
Yes. Mr. Basil?
Here.
Mrs. Bates?
Here.
Mrs. Dungan? Mrs. Hamel, here. Mr. Kurtz?
Here.
Mr. Rathgab? Mr. Dowski? And Mr. Martino?
Here. Under announcements, we have two agenda edits. Under item 12, letter B, 3, extracurricular, letter A, we're removing the item of Terrence Henderson, indoor percussion director, effective January 28, 2014. And under agenda item 12B4, substitute staff, we're adding Joseph Torsha, secondary principal, social studies.
Student government up.
Oh yeah, and we're moving. We're moving student government up from
nine D up to where?
7C.
We're moving the student government item from 9D to 7C.
And we will have a presentation.
Are there any other agenda edits?
I didn't see that here, any kind of motion to appoint a secretary for the board.
I didn't have Dr. Sanker put it on because Mrs. Hamel is still effectively the board secretary, and we have not yet voted to accept her resignation.
Okay.
So the vacancy doesn't necessarily exist, and I figured.
Do we want to do it under new business?
Well, do we need to do it tonight, is what I'm saying. I mean, the vacancy doesn't exist yet, and we have three board members missing.
Okay, I guess I can wait.
Yeah, I mean, unless the board members here actually want to be board secretary, we could vote on it.
I mean, I'll do it. It's a position I haven't held yet, and Monica sort of put me in on all the rules and duties of it. As his board president, I've had some experience working with secretary, so I'm happy to do it. But if we want to wait until everybody's here to vote on it, I'm happy to wait.
Oh, no, I didn't realize you were willing to do it. I knew you were the alternate. I didn't know you wanted to do it permanently.
It's not like I'm passionate for it, but I'm happy. Somebody has to do it, so I'm happy.
I'm okay with that.
You okay with voting? Okay, we could add that under new business. We'll vote on it tonight. The procedures for public participation are on the inside of the blue cover of the agenda. Are there any presentations by the public on agenda items?
Is this on?
Yeah, it's on.
Mr. Templin, excuse me 1 minute. Can you hear me now?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Question on financial 11-8.
cafeteria was at $15,000. Apparently, Sodexo has been telling their employees ever since the beginning of the year that they are $158,000 of the red. Now, I would like to know where the other $143,000 in the red has disappeared to. Or is Sodexo giving the employees ill information?
Now, Mr. Templin, I personally haven't heard Sodexo say that, so I don't know where that number is coming from. We do have the auditor coming to the Finance Committee meeting.
Apparently not anymore.
Oh, not anymore?
Conflict, but I guess we're scheduled.
We will look into it.
We'll look into that. I do not know that there is a difference of $143,000.
They were asked that afterwards, and they didn't want to. Didn't seem that they didn't come back to their employees. And while I'm stating about Sodexo, you know, we are the only school in the county, probably other counties, that have an outside food firm coming in to manage our food services. And I suggest we look into getting it back in-house, because I don't think we're doing what we should be doing with this Sodexo. I think it's detrimental to the way we're going to want to be with our finances. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Templin.
Oh, one more thing. The tax referendum that I was talking about on the committee of whole. It's not one that's going to decide to put that to the wayside.
There are two resolutions tonight. One is to opt into the Act 1 index. The other is to opt out of the Act 1 index. I don't know that we're even considering a referendum.
Okay. So if we do decide to want to put the tax on higher, I would hope to putting it on the vote, I would hope that we would be doing it for the sake of our senior citizens who's barely holding on to their house, so as it is, to do it for the sake of education, not for the sake of not having people pay for their children to play at play, because I think that would be very hard for the senior citizens of our community to spend a lot more taxes just to keep a ball going up and down the field. I think it's a whole lot better for the student to know how to read the lettering on that ball than to know how to throw it up and down the field. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Templin,
yes.
Just so you're aware, tonight we're not voting on whether or not we're going to raise taxes or not raise taxes. Tonight is just a vote to decide whether or not, if the school district were to raise taxes, whether or not we would limit the ability of the school district to raise taxes only to the Act 1 index, or to exceed that and ask for two special exceptions to the Act 1 index to allow us to raise the taxes a little bit higher than that. But there's no vote tonight to raise taxes or not raise taxes as it relates to this budget.
Okay, well, please keep in mind that our senior citizens are not in too good shape out there with their financial power.
Thank you.
I'm not one of them yet. I just look like one.
Are there any other public comments on the agenda? Seeing none, we will move on to recognition for January. Item 7A is the Daniel Boone High School Bioreactor Green Team. Dr. Sanker?
Thank you very much. I'm going to refer this to Mr. Hankel, who is going to begin the presentation to discuss the Green Team and the success of the Green Team. Mr. Hankel, would you come to the microphone, please?
Just wanted to take a couple minutes to, first of all, thank wanted to give a brief idea, as much as possible, of what these kids have accomplished in the last few months. First of all, they have met with Pennsylvania Representatives Maloney and Ed Nielsen from Philadelphia area. They met with both Pennsylvania Senators Judith Schwank and John C. Rafferty. They presented their research before Lieutenant Governor Jim Cawley. They received a letter of commendation from Governor Tom Corbett. They entertained U.S. Congressman Jim Gerlach, who came in and actually saw the algae bioreactor lab in the high school itself. They received letters of commendation from U.S. Congressman Patrick Meehan, received commendation letters from U.S. Senator Pat Toomey, received commendation letters from U.S. Senator Robert P. Casey. They also received staff members from both those senators' offices in the lab. They wanted to get a firsthand look at what the students were doing in the lab. Also, they received commendations from Delaware Senator Chris Coons, and they presented their research in Delaware Senator Chris Coons' office in Washington, D.C., and Senator Casey's office in Washington, D.C. They were honored by the state of Delaware in State Senate Resolution Number 11 of 2014 for their proactive engagement in looking for alternative energy sources. We were invited to the White House, but unfortunately that invitation, because of the closure of the federal government on the 21st, we did not get a chance to go to the White House. They also presented in the U.S. Department of Energy's Bioenergy Technology Office. Now, ladies and gentlemen, these are nine students altogether. We had five of us tonight. Nine of Danny Boone's students from the Danny Boone Area School District. It makes me wonder what other potential we have in Danny Boone that we have not yet tapped into. I gotta say that this has probably been the best experience of my professional career as a teacher, getting to work with these nine kids and seeing how impressed everybody we've spoken to have been with these kids. They also wanted me to take a moment on their behalf to thank some people who, without these people, they would not be here. These students recently sent letters of appreciation to several teachers within the school district. These teachers are from math teachers, they're art teachers, science teachers, music teachers, all these teachers that they've had from the time they came into kindergarten. They include, among others, Lord Bittler, Jared Ficoli, I think I'm missing that one, Mr. Sam McAmer, Mrs. Teresa Moslek, Mrs. Rebecca Major, Mr. Kenneth Gurman, Mr. Matt Palmer, Ms. Valerie Thompson, Mrs. Kelly Held, Mr. Matthew Peterman, Mrs. Stacy Hallman, Mr. Mons, now retired, Mrs. Johanna Gerhardt, Mrs. Kelly Boyer, Mr. Brian Bosler, Mr. Jeff Bailey, and Mrs. Susan Hinkle. We didn't get these students and train them. They were trained when we got them. We were just able to put what they had learned to use. So we also want to commend those teachers. We appreciate the community's support. We had over 5,000 likes on the district Facebook account, 3,500 plus visits on the webpage. So we appreciate that support. That helps us document that we're getting the words out for the Lexus Eco Final Challenge. Just so you know, the judging on that competition is going to be in mid-February. They'll let us know. And these kids right now, in addition to $10,000 they won already, they're in line to receive $30,000 if they win. And Megan Jolivet's words, what are we supposed to say?
We already won.
We already won. Okay? We already won. Pastor. Out there is mark February 19, 2014 on your calendar. The Green Team is sponsoring the second annual Parent Science Lab Night at the high school. We've opened it up to all district parents, families, and students, K-12. So please come out, let your young students as well as old students be inspired by what these kids have done, and maybe in the next few years this will be a yearly thing, not just a once-in-a-lifetime thing. Thank you very much.
Do you want them to?
Okay. Would you introduce your students that you brought with you, please, tonight?
Absolutely. We have Noah Coates, John Dewey, Ian Cook, Cindy Heavey, Tess Eager, and Megan Juliet.
We have nothing but great pride in what you've brought to our school, and want to thank you very much for all the efforts that you have gone forth and gone to the state capitol. Someone representing you took it upon themselves to go before the Delaware, the state of Delaware, House of Representatives for commendation. And you brought great pride to us by going to Washington, D.C. So we thank you very much for all of that. The honors that you bring hopefully will set the bar for the students coming after you, so that when the green team continues for next year, they know that they will have a goal and they'll have big shoes to fill. So we thank you very much for that. On behalf of the board, we have certificates to recognize your accomplishments. So if you'll come forward, will the board president and I hand you the certificates. Thank you. I believe we have one other student who participated, Dan Downs, and we have given you his certificate.
He already has a certificate.
He did receive it. Thank you very much.
I have a comment on that. The web page alone is very impressive. They documented all the different phases of the project, and I commend them for that also. Well,
thank you very much.
Yeah, I'd have a comment as well. It was an honor to see what these students are capable of when they came to Washington, D.C. They did a phenomenal job, and I know everybody who interacted with them was impressed, not only with their presentation, but with their professionalism. So I'd just like to add my statement of support for the Green Team and the wonderful things they're doing for our district and our community.
Thank you, Connor. Mr. Hankel, where are you now? Okay. I believe we have one other thing you wanted to cover this evening.
I'd like to introduce Mr. Bailey, who's our advisor for student government. We'll introduce our student government representative. Twice a year, they give an update to the board of the goings on at the high school. So, Mr. Bailey, if you would.
They have a presentation that we need to put out in the audience okay. as well. I don't know if we have to do it right away, but I
have to. Once again, it is a pleasure to be in front of the board. I believe this is the third or fourth or fifth time I've kind of lost track now after all these years. As Mr. Hankel said, twice a year, the student government gives a report to the board. At this point in time, I would like to introduce the officers of student government. Cody Mitchell is our president, who will be speaking with you in a 2nd. Along with him is Adam Banks, who is our treasurer, and Noah Unger, who is our secretary. So at this point in time, I'd like to turn it over to Cody to give his report to you guys here.
Thank you very much. Are there any questions for student government? Board
sounds
comments?
Sounds like you guys are very busy.
Yeah.
And May looks like it'll be a fun month.
Yeah,
absolutely. So thank you for the report. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Do you guys have an overhead that you wanted us to see?
No, we will have that email to you guys. So you guys can view that. We will have that for you guys.
Okay. Great, thank you very much.
Would you let people go that the board presented?
for the people that were here, just for the student government report or for the certificate presentations, if you wish to leave, you know, we'd understand. Moving on, this is also School Board Recognition Month, and I want to comment on that because there are people in the audience that know, while I sat as a member of the public, I often questioned why a school board would promote recognition of itself. Being on the board now, I find that this is not a school board initiative, that it's something that stems from the Pennsylvania School Board Association, and is really recognition of the time spent by the board members in school board activities with no reimbursement whatsoever. And sitting up here, I find how much time is being spent. Mrs. Bites and I are new to the board, so we're just learning this, but Mr. Basil, Mrs. Hamill, Mr. Kurtz, Mr. Daske, who's not here at the moment, they all have put in quite a bit of time, especially those that have served more than one term. So that being the case, that is the reason for the School Board Recognition Month.
And I think I'll take it from here. Thank you. January is School Director Recognition Month. And on behalf of the administration, faculty, and staff, I would like to take this opportunity to extend our appreciation to the directors serving on the Daniel Boone Area Board of School Directors. We honor our directors for their service and commitment to our children and our community. Thank you for your countless hours of volunteering and for helping our community foster the best learning environment for our students. We value your dedication and contributions to the education and future of our finest resource, our children. Assisting us with recognizing our school directors is the Daniel Boone Parent Teacher Council, who has provided refreshments this evening for the directors. A special thank you to the Parent Teacher Council for the delicious treats. In November of 2013, the Board of Directors of the Pennsylvania School Board Association passed a resolution recognizing January 2014 as School Director Recognition Month. I'd like to just share a bit of this resolution with you. Whereas the local boards have discharged their responsibilities to public education in a manner which has placed public education in the forefront of our educational systems. And whereas locally elected officials have distinguished themselves and their communities in this non-paid volunteer public service commitment. And whereas the contributions of these men and women should be recognized and appreciated by those who benefit from the workings of our public school system. Therefore, be it resolved that the Board of Directors of the Pennsylvania School Board Association hereby proclaims the month of January as School Director Recognition Month in this Commonwealth. Just a couple of facts. Did you know that there are 500 school districts in Pennsylvania and that all boards have 9 members, making up 4,500 school directors across the state of Pennsylvania? Did you know that school director elections are held every 2 years on a 5-4 rotation to ensure continuity? And that unless filling an unexpired term, all board members are elected to 4-year terms. Did you know that Daniel Boone School District has two vacancies on the Board of School Directors now, and that we are now accepting applications for school director from two specific regions. That information has been advertised and is on our district website. So if you're interested in applying, I'm putting a plug in so that we have applications to take to the board for selection for these two seats that are will be vacant very shortly. Although school directors are elected locally, the state constitution delegates to them the responsibility to administer the school system as agents of the General Assembly. And that's something a lot of people don't know, that they are charged with this duty to represent the state constitution as agents of the General Assembly. All directors are volunteers and serve without pay. They say that a typical school director is male, well-educated, married with two or three children, attending public schools, and voluntarily devotes 16 to 20 hours per month to school board business. 16% are retirees, 7% are homemakers, 9% are self-employed or business owners, and 6% are office supervisors. 35% of school directors are female. 57% of all districts involve students at their local board meetings. Of those districts, 95% rate their involvement with students at meetings as satisfactory or highly satisfactory. During the meeting, most boards, or 51%, allow two public comments, as we do here at Daniel Boone. Most, 72%, impose time limits on those comment periods, as we do at Daniel Boone. Pennsylvania school directors continue to keep adequate school funding at the top of the list of the most important educational concerns facing public schools. This evening, I will be presenting to the board a certificate from the Pennsylvania School Board Association, which is composed of those 4,500 school directors from across the state of Pennsylvania, thanking them for their service to our district. Carol Bites. Monica Hamill. Rich Martino, our president. Connor Kurtz, we will make sure you get your certificate.
Thank you.
Andrew Basil. And we will be presenting our directors who are unable to attend this evening for multiple reasons, their certificates as soon as we see them. Thank you very much for your service to our district.
Thank you, Dr. Sanker. Before moving on, I was remiss at the beginning of the meeting. I did not announce, but we will be having an executive session following this meeting to discuss some personnel issues. Item 8, under routine approvals, do I hear a motion to approve the minutes of the November 25th voting meeting, as well as the December 2nd reorganization meeting and the December 2nd committee of the whole meeting?
So moved.
Just
say.
Moved by Andrew Basil, seconded.
Moved by Andrew Basil, seconded by Carol Bites.
Okay, this will be unanimous. You need a vote.
Well, we haven't done that yet. So.
Okay, so.
Mrs. Hamill?
Okay, the motion is for 8A. Motion made by Mr. Basil, seconded by Mrs. Bites. Mr. Basil?
Yes.
Mrs. Bites?
Yes.
Mrs. Dungan? Mrs. Hamill, yes. Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Rathgab? Ms. Twardowski? And Mr. Martino?
Yes.
Motion passed.
Item 8B, do
make
I hear
a motion to approve 8B and C.
There's a motion to, do I hear a second?
I second.
There's a motion to approve 8B and C by Mr. Basil, seconded by Mrs. Hamill. Mrs. Hamill, you want to? Are there any questions or comments on 8B and C? Mrs. Hamill, you want to call the roll, please?
Mrs. Bites?
Yes.
Mrs. Dungan? Mrs. Hamill? Yes. Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Rathgab? Mr. Twardowski? Mr. Basil?
Yes.
And Mr. Martino?
Yes.
Motion passed.
Item 9, presentation by board members. Any secretary correspondence?
No.
Berks County Intermediate Unit report.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Martino. The Berks County Intermediate Unit Board of Directors met on January 16, 2014. A new board member was seated, Paul D. Stengel. He is the BCIU board member from Boyertown Area School District. His term expires on June 30, 2014. There were many routine approvals. One of the most interesting and newsworthy events was the ratification of an agreement with the Reading School District for the BCIU to functionally take over the administration of that school district for the rest of the academic year. Dr. John J. George, who is the executive director of the BCIU, will be taking over as superintendent of record for the Reading Area School District. And Dr. Jill M. Hackman will become acting executive director at the BCIU. That was the main event at the board meeting, and you've probably read about it in Berks County. If there are any questions, board members can feel free to contact me.
Are there any questions or comments on Mr. Kurtz's report?
Mr. Kurtz, did they elaborate at all how they're going to be doing two jobs?
They have not. There is a chain of command that has been restructured. While Dr. George is still executive director of the BCIU, all of his powers have been transferred to his assistant director, who is now the acting director, and he is, from what I understand, pretty much acting as the superintendent of the Reading School District. I can get you more information if you'd like to speak with me after the meeting. That would probably be the best option.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions or comments? Seeing none, thank you, Mr. Kurtz. Is there a report on the Berks Career and Technology Board?
No, that would be tomorrow, Ms. Podowski.
Seeing none, we've already had the student government report. On the legislative report, just briefly, in December, Mr. Kurtz and I were invited to a meeting with the Birdsboro Borough Manager regarding their proposed village concept, wherein a Boyer's Market and surrounding stores would be constructed. They're having their final vote on that project on February 10th at 6 p.m. in the Birdsboro Borough Hall, after which they anticipate making a presentation to the school board requesting a LERTA, which is a local economic revitalization tax abatement. Earlier this month, Mr. Kurtz, Mr. Rathgab, and I attended an Amity Township Planning Commission meeting in which they discussed the potential construction of a business park on Limekiln Road. If it's actually developed, they will also be requesting a LERTA. And subsequent to that Planning Commission meeting, Mr. Basil, Mrs. Bites, and I attended an Amity Township Board of Supervisors meeting in which they discussed their proposed village concept designed to promote commercial growth. But at this time, it's simply a zoning change proposal, and there are not any specific plans to build anything. The Senate Finance Committee is working on amendments to Senate Bill 76 and could soon vote the bill out of committee for discussion and a vote on passage. And the last item is that Governor Corbett will unveil his proposed 2014-15 state budget on February 4th, but the final version is not required until June 30th, so whatever he proposes will have to be passed by both the House and the Senate. So we will have no idea on his budget, the final numbers, until June or later. Are there any questions on a legislative report? Seeing none, we'll move on. There's no buildings and grounds report, so we'll move on to financial approvals.
I just want to actually mention, there is a finance committee meeting this Wednesday night, 7 o'clock in the Matthew Brook building, if anybody wants to attend.
Mr. Martino, there's an area on the agenda for other reports. I'd just like to report that the Policy Review Committee met tonight prior to this meeting, and we discussed a few policies, including looking at our class size policy, our policy development policy, and one item.
Excuse me, Mr. Kurtz, you broke up, but the other policy, it was class size, sports boosters, and policy development. Is that the three you were going to mention?
Yes, that is the case. Can you hear me?
Yes, now we can.
Okay. Yeah, that is the Policy Review Committee is investigating, and of course the board would have to approve this if we were to go this route, but instead of just reviewing policy, also investigating perhaps new policies and revisions to, not just revisions policies, but new policies, and just panning out policy ideas. So not just reviewing, but becoming more of an active policy committee. That's something the board will need to discuss, and we're not acting on it this time, but it was floated as an idea. Thank you.
Any questions for Mr. Kurtz? Thank you, Mr. Kurtz. Moving on to financial approvals.
On the motion for 11A through E.
Is there?
Second.
There's a motion to approve 11A through E by Mr. Basil, seconded by Mrs. Hamill.
Any questions?
Any questions or comments? Seeing none, Mrs. Hamill, you want to call the roll?
Motion 11A through E. Motion made by Mr. Basil, seconded by Mrs. Hamill. Mrs. Hamill, yes. Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Rathgab, Ms. Lodowski, Mr. Basil?
Yes.
Mrs. Bites?
Yes.
And Mr. Martino?
Yes.
Motion passed.
The next item is motion 11F to approve the adoption of the Act 1 resolution to opt in.
So moved.
Is there a second?
I second.
Motion to approve the adoption of Act 1 was made by Mr. Basil, seconded by Mrs. Hamill. Are there any comments? Questions?
I'll just make a comment. In the past, as a board, in the last couple of years, we've voted to opt in so that if the board needed to, the option was available during budget discussions to increase taxes above the Act 1 index to include special exceptions. The board has never opted to do that at the end of the day, but we wanted to make sure we had all opportunities available for us should we need them. And that's just a little bit of the history on it for those that aren't familiar with it. I think it's a good idea. Leave all options on the table. And that's the reason why I'm put forth the motion to approve that adoption.
Just so everyone understands, opting in means that we have the ability to raise taxes to the index plus the one exception for pensions.
Two special exceptions.
Well, the one we don't qualify for this year.
Yes, special education.
No, we don't qualify.
That's out. Just the one for pensions. Yeah.
Okay.
And just, you know, as far as the terminology goes, the opt-in means that you're opting into the Act 1 preliminary budget process, which requires you to advertise and make available for public inspection a preliminary budget, which has to be approved by the board no later than February 19th. Pursuant to this resolution, that approval is anticipated to occur at the Committee of the Whole meeting, which is February 10th.
Thank you, Mr. Supers. And the opting out would limit us to just the Act 1 index moving forward. I understand what Mr. Basil said about leaving all options open. Personally, I feel like having that option, I think there are savings to be made, and I think there are items in the budget that where we can tighten our belts, and I don't think having too many options, I think that would preclude us from taking all the steps necessary, but that's just my thought. Are there any other comments or questions?
I just have a question. Opting in, does that put a burden on us to make some sort of reporting requirements?
Well, what you have to do if you opt in, then you're required to approve a preliminary budget. And that has been prepared by the district administration. You would have to make that available for public inspection 20 days before the board actually approves the preliminary budget. You would also have to advertise that preliminary budget at least 10 days prior to the approval. And again, that's all anticipated for approval on February 10th. Opting out means that you opt out of the preliminary budget process. And again, it's very important to note that we're only talking about the preliminary budget. That preliminary budget can be changed at any time between its adoption and the adoption of the final budget, which isn't due until June 30 of this year.
And we've done that, you know, every year for the last couple of years. You know, it's basically the budget that we've already presented to the public as is. And you know, I think it's incumbent on us to let them know that it's a preliminary budget, that if there's nothing, you know, set in stone there, and that, you know, we can continue to work and try to improve that budget, which we've always done. Between now and the end of June, I think the reason why this is just a critical issue is if you vote to opt out, we're essentially limiting ourselves in terms of the overall tax increase that may be available to us. And, you know, I'm not in favor of a tax increase of any kind, but I certainly want to make sure I have all options available to me as a board member to, in case we need to do what.
Could you refresh my memory on what the dollar value of that is?
Mr. Boyer. Could you break down the two different dollar values? I have it here. Let's see.
The Act 1, the 2.8, the index is $782,000. The PEASRs would be an additional $326,000.
So it's going from 0.7 mils to 1 mil.
And if I remember correctly, Mr. Sheldon Ridge, Kim had suggested that we opt in according to his findings.
Thank you.
And his five-year plan.
Any other questions or comments? Seeing none, Mrs. Hamill.
Motion is for 11F. Motion made by Mr. Basil, seconded by Mrs. Hamill. Mr. Kurtz?
No.
Mr. Basil?
Yes.
Mrs. Bites?
Yes.
Mrs. Hamill? Yes. And Mr. Martina?
No.
Motion passed.
Since we've already opted in, we don't need to vote on opting out, correct?
Right.
Okay. Motion to accept the 2012-13 local audit.
I would make a motion that we table that. We haven't had an opportunity to speak to the auditor, and it doesn't look like I'm going to have that opportunity on Wednesday night to do that. We'll have to reschedule. I'm happy to call her directly, which I believe Mr. Boyer just provided me with her contact information today.
but I haven't had a chance to talk to her. And, you know, I think that question needs to be resolved.
I agree.
Are you seconding?
Is it a motion?
There's a motion to table.
Motion
which
to table.
Would require a second.
I second.
There's no discussion on that. There's just a vote on the motion to table.
Motion by Mr. Basil, seconded by Mrs. Bites. Mrs. Hamill?
Oh. Okay, motion to table 11H. Mr. Basil?
Yes.
Mrs. Bites?
Yes.
Mrs. Hamill, yes. Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
And Mr. Martina?
Yes.
Motion passed.
Personnel approvals.
Motion for 12A1A.
There's a motion for 12A1A. Is there a second?
Second for motion.
Motion made by Mr. Basil for A1A, seconded by Mrs. Hamill. Any questions or comments?
Mr. Haas, I just wanted to thank you for your work in the school district for the last few years. I think you've been a real asset to the district and to this board. You've done a great deal of work to improve our infrastructure, our network security, and draw a high level of professionalism, I think, to our IT office. And I wish you well in your endeavors, and sorry to see you leave. But thank you.
Any other questions or comments? Mrs. Hamill?
Motion is for 12A1A. Motion made by Mr. Basil, seconded by Mrs. Hamill. Mrs. Bites?
Yes.
Mrs. Hamill, yes. Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Basil?
Yes.
And Mr. Martino?
Yes.
Motion passed.
The next item is following professional resignation of Angela.
I'll make a motion for 12B.
We're still on. Just A1A.
Oh, A1A.
So
we have A1A.
Making a motion for 12B.
No, it's A1B.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, you only A1 did the
two.
First one.
A1, 2, and 12B.
It's just
12A2 and 12B is my motion.
Okay, so the motion is for 12A2 and all of 12B.
Correct. As amended.
As amended. Is there a second?
Second.
Motion by Mr. Basil, seconded by Mrs. Hamill.
Mrs. Hamill?
Questions or comments?
Yeah, I thought we were looking into the necessity of the indoor percussion instructors.
I'm sorry.
Indoor percussion instructors.
If I could speak to that.
I know that one is being
He just withdrew his name today.
Okay. And we will not be replacing that?
We are not. So there will only be two individuals doing the percussion instruction. I was told this is very similar to having multiple coaches in a sports team. And don't ask me about sports too much, but an offensive coach, a defensive coach, etc. And this is, excuse me. Percussion, I don't know if our music teacher's here at all, but I know that with the percussion instruction, they break these 20 students down into different disciplines that they have to instruct in. Now there'll be two instructors for 20 students, which this is a pre-approved budget item that was included in last year's budget, so this money has been budgeted for this school year for these instructors.
What is the term, please, for the...
Just this year. This is an extra...
What does the percussion mean? How long? What is their term? Or have they done? And what is their term? when do they end? Is it January to March? January to March?
Mr. Hinkle? Hankel?
It's a winter activity.
It's a winter activity.
It did already start.
Thank you.
And these instructors? So they're already helping out?
Ms. Weiss, we have in the past requested that approvals of positions, coaching positions, and stipends and things of that nature be brought to the board before the activity actually starts and commences, so that we have an opportunity as a board to address those things.
I'm a little perplexed about that.
Yeah.
Has Mr. Anderson helped us also at this point?
It's been informal. It hasn't been anything formal.
Well, let me ask you. If I understand correctly, you're saying the board has asked that these be brought to the board ahead of time. And if I'm reading these correctly, if I heard Mr. Hankel correctly, these people are already working for us?
The problem with the indoor percussion, you have people who have resigned.
Could you come to the mic, please? Mr. Hankel, what I've seen, though, both as a member of the public and my short time on the board, is these seem to be recurring, and the one that resigned the other day would be an emergency situation. What about the others?
I don't know. Yeah, we weren't
well.
So have we already approved other indoor instructors? Is that what you're saying? Indoor professional instructors? Were other instructors approved prior to the program in December? Is this too new?
Just to fill the positions that have become open.
So the work positions approved?
As far as they were today.
And now they're vacated?
So
wouldn't the money be already allocated?
The money's allocated. These are contracts approved. These are approved contracts, meaning supplemental contracts.
Essentially, these
people, not the contracts.
These stipend amounts are approved as per our collective bargaining agreement. And as part of the overall budget, if we're offering indoor percussion, then there's a certain budgeted amount that we approved as a school board last June for those slots. Now, in terms of the actual people filling the posts, as a board, we approve those things as the year goes around and people step up for those positions. What we've asked in the past as a school board is, can we get these names prior to the activity actually beginning? Because if we don't approve somebody and they've already started coaching or whatever it is they're doing, there's a problem. And secondly, they shouldn't be getting compensated for work that they haven't been approved to do yet. So therein lies the rub. And, it's something that continues to come up from time to time.
So, Dr. Sanker, I think what we're trying to convey is this has been an issue. The board in the past has already said we want these names ahead of time. Barring an emergency, we want the names ahead of time.
That makes sense to me, and I would encourage the administration to do that. In an ideal world, we can do it. With the holidays and weather and so forth, I don't know the reason why this is delayed in coming before the board, except in some of these very special positions, it's tough to get instructor. So maybe they came forward at the last minute. I don't know all of the circumstances, but in the future, I can tell you that since I know that it's now an issue, I will try and get it to the board as quickly as possible.
Mr. Martino, I'd like to just jump in, and this exact same situation happened last year, if I'm not mistaken, with the exact same program. we can't have people working for us prior to us hiring them. That is inappropriate in my mind. We discussed this before. I don't know why it's an issue again, because the previous board made it very clear that that was entirely inappropriate. I think we have to address this, and I don't know if we could do anything now.
Well, Mr. Kurtz, to answer your comment, it was just addressed to Dr. Sanker, I believe, for the first time. I think she agrees with everything we've all said. So going forward, I think you'll see a change. I can't answer for what's happened in the past.
We do have, a committee of the whole meeting where we could have addressed this in December, or we could have addressed it at a committee of the whole meeting as well. It doesn't have to wait until, if there's an emergency situation, they need approval, we can address it. We meet every 2 weeks. And I think we have an opportunity to address it. I made a motion to approve it just because these guys are already there, they're already working. To not approve it, as far as Jamie Mills and Matt Phillips are concerned, I don't have any reason not to approve them as a percussion coaches. Hence my reason for moving forward with it. I didn't see anything out of line in terms of the stipends that they're being paid. However, correct me if I'm wrong, I don't know if it was Mr. Subers, you would recall this, we have to go back and take a look at this. I wasn't sure whether we prorated the stipends based on when the board actually approved the minute of these.
I don't recall that.
We did.
Yeah, I think we ought to take a look at the minutes to verify that. Because there was a big brouhaha about this.
From last year, right.
Well, assuming we approve them, though, these stipends are effective tomorrow. So there would be no reason to prorate
anything. But the stipend is for the entire. If they started in January 1st, the stipend would include work from January 1st to January 28th, for example. Whereas I believe as a board we had discussed prorating the stipends as of the date they become effective. So you would take that $1,262 divided by the total number of days and then start January 28th. So it wouldn't be a full stipend.
I would just note, looking at the committee, the whole, these names were on your agenda, although not for action, on the January 13th committee. All
right, we asked Dr. Frank to look into the necessity of all three positions.
I did. I asked that question.
And you're comfortable with 2 for 20 students?
I am, and only because I'm going to go with the recommendation of the high school principal who spoke with the music director. I know very little about percussion, although I should, but if they tell me that it is very specific and they need it to compete, then I have to take their word for it. And on a $50 million budget, we're spending an awful lot of time on less than $2,500. So I ask that you approve it, please.
I think that the issue here is
the timing.
Well, time. It's a big deal, because it's not just these two positions. It could be 27 positions that were often thrown at us as a board to approve at one time, and that's a substantial amount of money. And I don't want to do anything that's going to contradict previous board policy that we've created. So, and it was done for a reason, and that was specifically so that people were incentivized to bring things to us in a timely fashion.
And I'm going to try and move that.
Yeah, no, I understand that. I'm not blaming you for the current situation. I'm just saying that unless there's a penalty for not following the procedure, the behavior continues. Unabated year in, year out. And what's the point of even voting on these things if they're already doing the jobs?
But that's why it's a big deal. It's not the amount of money. It's the fact that it has come up previously.
Times, I believe, too. So I know Dr. Sanker is new, but we have a high school principal, we have assistant superintendent, we have other people in management who are aware of this issue. So why is it continuing to happen? And what will the penalty be?
Well, I mean, I would suggest that you amend the motion to approve the appointments with a possible proration of the stipend based on the action taken by the board last year under a similar circumstance.
How do we accept that? Somebody wants to make that motion?
Oh,
Understood. You okay? And then, Ms. Hamill, do you accept that amendment to the motion?
Can you repeat it so I can write it down?
Yes, I would say that the motion would be to approve the appointments as presented, with a possible proration of the stipends consistent with the board action taken last year under similar circumstances.
And that goes along with the first motion, that's just as amended.
Correct.
And presented by the solicitor. Okay. So motion for 12A, 2, 12B,
and B,
as amended.
And presented by the solicitor.
And presented by the solicitor. First by Mr. Basil and seconded by Mrs. Hamill. Mrs. Hamill, yes. Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Basil?
Yes.
Mrs. Bikes?
Yes.
And Mr. Martino?
Yes.
Motion passed.
May I make a comment on that particular section? Going forward, when we get extracurricular approvals, can we get it in a chart form so we can see who is already out there in all the different activities that are running, say the winter band units, and we see how they fit in to like indoor percussion, and then who it is and what their dates are, what the season is, and so we know at any one time who we have, what is the scope of our extracurricular program. Is that realistic to
absolutely
want to see that?
Yeah, that information is readily available.
Absolutely. Yeah, and Dr. Sanker, I think some kind of chart like that would be beneficial to all the new board members especially, and we have two more coming on, so.
Thank you.
I've been asked to move up item 13C. Is there, if there's no objection, can we do that? So, is there a motion to accept the following donations from the Blazer Foundation?
So moved.
And they'd like to make a presentation.
They have a presentation to make.
What section is
it? It's moved by Mr. Basil, seconded by Mrs. Hamill, and I understand that there's a presentation to be made.
Who wouldn't vote first? Or vote?
No, I wouldn't. Presentation.
Pardon?
It's hard to
probably do. Thank you. And I misstated that. It was not from the Fat Laser Foundation. It was from the Birdsboro Legion. There was some confusion on the agenda. I apologize.
Do we have these people here? Let them come. All right.
Moving on to item 13, programs.
We need to finish.
Yes, we have a motion on the table.
Oh, 13C is on the table for the donations from the Blazer Foundation. I'm sorry. Questions or comments?
I'd just like to say thank you. This is great. Great for our students.
I would also like to commend the Blazer Foundation as well. In a very short time, it's obvious that they're up and running and starting to contribute to the school district in a positive way, and I want to thank Ms. Conlon for her efforts and everyone else who has donated to the foundation.
Other comments or questions? Mrs. Hammond?
Motion on the table is 13C. Motion made by Mr. Basil, seconded by Mrs. Hamill. Mr. Kirk?
Yes.
Mr. Basil?
Yes.
Mrs. Bates?
Yes.
Mrs. Hamill, yes. Mr. Martino?
Yes.
Motion passed.
We have item 13A.
Make a motion for 13A and B.
Second.
There's a motion by Mr. Basil to approve items 13A and B, and seconded by Mrs. Hamill. Any comments or questions?
Just in the interest of transparency, I just want to point out that the 375 for the PASBA training I do benefit from, and I appreciate the opportunity to go and do the rigors of the position. So
the other two, I
just want to put this down.
Should we say up to six?
The opportunity to go for that training, and I hope it's well spent. I hope that the district will find it well spent on the rest of my education.
I think it's a great thing, and I think that every board member should participate in it. There's a lot to learn in a short period of time, and it's invaluable. It's an invaluable experience.
Assuming we have the two new members by the end of February, could we approve this up to six?
We have a second motion or a second, vote to bring them into the fold as well.
Yeah. Increase that up to six. Increase the number to six.
Well, they may, I think we just, that's right, we won't have a
motion to approve a maximum.
I would suggest amending it to a maximum of six.
Ms. Hamill, do you accept that amendment?
Yes.
Motion's been amended.
Motion's amended by Mr. Basil, seconded by Mrs. Hamill.
Yes.
Any other comments or questions? Mrs. Hamill.
Mr. Basil?
Yes.
Mrs. Bates?
Yes.
Mrs. Hamill, yes. Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Martino?
Yes.
Motion passed.
There's no policy report and there's no transportation report. Old business. Item 16A. Is there a motion to approve limiting executive sessions to no more than 1 hour unless extended by majority vote?
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Kurtz. Is there a second?
Second.
So moved by Mr. Kurtz, seconded by Mrs. Bites. Comments or questions?
I just don't think it's a good idea. I think there's a lot to get discussed in a short period of time. We don't meet often as a board. And limiting those discussions to an hour and then having to vote every hour or whatever the process might be to move it forward. I think if there's a certain group of people who don't want an issue to be discussed, whatever it may be, I mean, as a board we will disagree on things,
then it's a great tool to shut down discussion. It can be used for, I think, you know, ill-suited purposes. And so I would just hazard a guess. I think in the past when we've had an executive sessions and people couldn't stay the whole time, they let it be known. We try to work very hard to accommodate their schedules and get those specific issues that we need to address prior to their departure. And then if they have to leave, we've always made an effort to include them.
I'm unable to hear. Okay, I'm back. I couldn't hear anything.
I too, have found that the executive sessions, being the nature of what we're going to be talking about, isn't always a quick solution. And hopefully you get finished in an hour. I mean, our goal is to be there all night. But I think we need to say, no more than an hour, unless you sit there and vote on it. You might be in the middle of discussion, and then they say, well, it's over now, we're all going home, and not come to a conclusion. I don't.
Is there a time limit that either of you would be comfortable with restricting it to, where you could say, well, after this point, it's not really a quality conversation anyway?
I think that's the job of the board president, to kind of keep control of the executive sessions and run those meetings. And I can say that in the past there'd be something we've been there for hours, three or four hours sometimes after a late meeting here. It's a drag, right? But at the other times, people have said, look, I got to be out of here by this time. And we discuss two or three things and then we're gone. And we make arrangements to have a phone call or something else later on. I think the challenge that we've found is everybody's so busy. You can see it tonight, maybe. There's only very few of us here, that sometimes coordinating those phone calls or having a follow-up meeting is difficult to get accomplished. And if you've got everybody there or aren't committed to be here, sometimes it's easier just to knock it out. But look, anybody at any time could stand up, or five people can stand up and say, look, we're done talking about this, we're going home, we're going to bed, and the conversation's over. I mean, you don't have the majority of the board there anymore to try to move an issue to closure. So.
Well, let me make three comments, since this was my idea. First of all, it says it can be extended by majority vote, so we're not limited to 1 hour. Secondly, the purpose of it was to make people be more concise in their presentation rather than sitting there for 3 or 4 hours. And the third thing is, in regard to what you said, Mr. Basil, so the board members would expect that if the board president says, excuse me, you're going on and on and on, you need to cut it down. Everybody will understand that?
I think it's the job of the board president to try to rein board members in and keep them on topic. Absolutely. Yep. And if someone's running on, you gotta let them know, hey, look, we got your point, and then next, you get nine people in there talking about an issue. It doesn't take very long to gobble up some time. That's only if you're talking about one issue. You should talk about three or four different issues, or five. I can appreciate the idea behind it. Don't get me wrong. Nobody wants to be here forever. We all have families, and we need to go to work the next morning and all that kind of stuff. But at the same time, I just feel like setting an arbitrary time to finish our business, particularly when it comes to executive session items, is... In the past, I've seen that type of thing used improperly.
Any other comments or questions? Mrs. Hammond?
Okay, the motion is 16A. Motion made by Mr. Kurtz, seconded by Mrs. Bites. Mrs. Bites?
No.
I want to make sure I understand this. So to back up a little bit here. So what we're voting yes or no is a motion to approve that limiting executive session to no more than 1 hour unless extended by majority vote.
Correct.
No. No. Mrs. Hamill says no. Mr. Kurtz?
No.
Mr. Basil?
No.
And Mr. Martino?
Yes.
Motion passed.
No, motion failed.
I'm sorry,
motion
failed.
I would like to move item 16B, amended to read, motion to approve utilizing a voice vote rather than a roll call vote on routine agenda resolutions with a recorded roll call vote to be taken at the request of a school director. Would you like me to read that motion again?
Yes, please.
Motion to approve utilizing a voice vote rather than a roll call vote on routine agenda resolutions with a recorded roll call vote to be taken at the request of a school director.
Making that motion, Connor?
Yes.
Is there a second?
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Kurtz, seconded by Mr. Basil. Any comments, questions?
Yes, the reason I moved this amended resolution is because I do believe this could speed up the process. That being said, if any one director wants to vote per person on the record, I believe it should be, and that will increase transparency, but it will also allow the board to hopefully expedite procedures, and then maybe we could have longer executive sessions or discussions or whatever, because we won't be spending all our time voting and we can spend our time discussing. But I'd like to make it clear that if one board member would like it recorded, then it needs to be recorded as a roll call vote. Otherwise, it could be a voice vote on items that it's appropriate for.
And I appreciate you making that amendment, Mr. Kurtz. I think the only question I have is how are we defining routine, and is that going to be indicated on the agenda so we know which ones are routine items and which ones are non-routine items? Like, for example, the Act 1 resolution, is that routine because we've got to vote on it every year? Or is that something that is a non-routine item?
My view on that, and I guess I could let Dr. Sanker and the board president speak as the ones who write the agenda, is that your routine items would be your personnel approvals. It would be up to the board, really. The items we vote on every month. Not every year, but every month. And the items that pass, that there isn't objection on. If anybody wants to vote no and wants their vote recorded, then they have a right to request that. But instead of saying doing a roll call for every single item, where most of them are 9-0, if we could just say yay or nay as a group, I think we could really move things along.
There are items on here right now that are headed routine approvals. Item 8 was the heading routine approvals, and I think others of these could have been listed under routine approvals also. Now, the two resolutions obviously aren't routine, and I think they would require a roll call vote.
There is no definition. I mean, certainly specific resolutions would be, you know, that are brought to the district on an as-needed basis or on an emergent basis would not be routine. Certain votes that are required to be recorded, like approval of an intermediate unit budget, vocational technical school budget, appointments to those boards. Approval of your own budget. I mean, they're certainly not routine, but I mean, personnel approvals can be considered routine.
That's where I was going with it.
Business approvals.
And I just wanted to, I guess my comment would be, I'm all for the idea of speeding things up. I guess my only comment would be, I think we ought to have it somewhere indicated on here with either routine in parentheses or something like that, so that we all are aware, okay, this is going to be a routine one. It's going to make the job of the president easier and the secretary in terms of conducting those things. And we're all aware of, okay, this is just a yay, nay, and this one's a, you know, a roll call.
Well, just to make it easier, since the concept would be that there would be less roll call votes, you note the ones that are roll call and the ones that aren't indicated for a roll call vote are routine unless requested otherwise.
Right.
I like that.
And then at the start, when we do agenda edits, if we don't want something to be removed from that section.
Yeah, at the BCIU we do this, and if any director at the beginning during agenda edit says, I'd like to take that item separately, then it's taken separately. I think that would be a good solution as well.
Other questions or comments? Mrs. Hammer.
Nope. Motion is 16B, as amended by Mr. Kerr. Motion first by Mr. Kurtz, seconded by Mr. Basil. Mrs. Hamel, yes. Mr. Basil?
Yes.
Mrs. Bites?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
And Mr. Martino?
Yes.
Motion passed.
Item 16C, a motion to approve adding a member of the high school student government as a non-voting student representative to the board of directors, beginning with the September 2014 voting meeting.
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Kurtz. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Mrs. Hamel. Comments or questions?
I think this is a great addition to our board. So many other districts do it, and it will be a great opportunity for the board to hear more from students and a great opportunity for students to interact with the board. I think this is a great idea all around.
One thing that we'll need to do if this is enacted is we'll need to bring a policy before the board so that procedurally everything is spelled out. And so that's why this is scheduled to start in September, so that the policy committee would have an opportunity to develop a policy that will support this motion.
I would, my personal take on this, I'd like to see the policy before we put this into place, because I just have so many questions. I mean, does this mean that they're up here every night with us, or is it was sort of as we discussed at the committee whole? They're, you know, in the audience, they report to us on what they're doing on a monthly basis. I would love to hear that. And then, you know, they can stay for the rest of the meeting and participate as they see fit. But if they need to go home and study for something or get ready for a game, they can get up and walk out. I mean, I'd hate to have somebody sitting up here for 3.5 hours during a board meeting or something like that, because they're a representative of the board and they're going to sit up here at the table with us. I guess I'd like to have this fleshed out a little bit before we vote on it. We got the time. We've got, you know, 7 months.
So you'd like to see the policy developed first. Dr. Sanker, would you vote on that?
I can certainly bring a policy to the committee, and we can work on the specifics there and bring it to the full board.
Yeah, I'm sure it's not inventing the wheel. We should have some school districts that do this and policies that exist.
No, it's early on when I was mentioning about, did you know about the board? There are 56% of the school districts in Pennsylvania have a student representative on the board. And where better to learn about the role of the board and parliamentary procedure and et cetera would be right here. And yes, they would have a seat at the board table. If they have a conflict with another activity, they don't come that evening. Obviously, if they're non-voting, and the material that they get would be the material that goes to the public. So, but yes, they're here 3 hours, but that's the commitment. If they want to do it, they know that it could be a three-hour meeting.
Where I first saw this was several years ago at OJ Roberts. They had the student council president as a member of their board, and the student council president sat with the board, made a presentation, was listed on the agenda to make a student council presentation, but sat there the whole meeting. Mr. Kurtz, there were suggestions to table this until the policy was drawn up. It's your motion.
All right, I would like to comment before I make any further motion. I think this is going to be great, and I would be fine working with the committee, policy committee, to work on the proposal. I assisted the Pottstown School District with the creation of their student member proposal, and I've heard that's working very well. So on that note, we can develop the policy first. We do have time, so I will withdraw my motion, and I would ask the administration to bring a policy before the policy committee, and we'll develop it.
I think At this point, the proper procedure would just entertain a motion to table by someone that did not make the original motion.
I'll make a motion to table.
Is there a second?
I second that.
Okay. Motion by Mr. Basil to table the item 16C, seconded by Mrs. Bites.
We have a vote on that, Mrs.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Basil?
Yes.
Mrs. Bites?
Yes.
Mrs. Hamill, yes. And Mr. Martino?
Yes.
Motion passed.
Item 16D is a motion to...
Mr. Martino, can I also, as a member of the policy committee, ask that the board members send suggestions for what their vision of that is, so we can try to incorporate everybody's ideas into comprehensive policy?
Yeah, I think that's a great idea. I don't really know if I have a vision for this, so...
But if you just have one little piece,
absolutely.
Then maybe we should do that formation.
Good suggestion.
Item 16D, a motion to approve the appointment of three directors to serve as liaisons to the township and borough meetings for the following regions: Union Township, Amity Township, and the borough of Birdsboro.
Do you want to wait on this until we have all board members present and two new board members appointed, or do you want to go ahead and do this?
Hi. With such a sparse attendance tonight, I think it would be best to wait.
Then I move we table item D until the next voting meeting.
Well, is there a second?
If we, excuse me, if you wait till the next voting meeting, Connor?
Yeah.
Yes.
That's cool. You can work. Yeah, that'll work. Okay.
I second the motion.
Any comments or questions? Vote, Mrs. Hamill.
Motion for 16D is to be tabled until the next voting meeting. Motion made by Mr. Kurtz, seconded by Mrs. Bites. Mr. Basil?
Yes.
Sorry. Mrs. Bites?
Yes.
Mrs. Hamill, yes. Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
And Mr. Martino?
Yes.
Motion passed.
Under new business, item 17A, a motion to approve the agreement between the Daniel Boone Area School District and Ray Associates to conduct a superintendent search at a cost not to exceed $15,500. Is there a motion?
I'm sorry.
Still moved.
Wait.
Is there a second? Then you can have discussion.
I'll second.
Moved by Mr. Kurtz, seconded by Mr. Basil. Comments or questions?
Mr. Subers, did you have any comments?
I would just say that this really is a proposal as presented. If you read the proposal, it says that they will present the district with a contract form. I would recommend that the motion be amended to read that the final agreement to be approved by the district administration with assistance and review by the district solicitor. And I would note, as far as the terms, it's a not to exceed. They do indicate in the proposal that it can be terminated at any time and that you would only owe for services up to the date of termination.
But I think we need to be able to quantify what those services are. You know what I'm saying? And, the contract should spell out what those terms are, what's being done, at what time, how much money that might cost.
Well, and that's the other thing that I don't know is there's a schedule of activities.
They kind of had a schedule. I forget what page number it's on. It wasn't really an itemized. It was kind of like, these are the things we're going to take care of for you. And
It's a blank timeline.
Right.
If I could comment there, I spoke today with one of their references on the Springford School Board, and they said that they work with you to create a timeline. So they will fill that in with the district to meet our needs. So the timeline is, and I asked the reference how their timeline worked, and he said that they took about 4 to 5 months, but they are willing to go as quickly or as slowly as you want, and you can begin to interview really as soon as you are ready. So I think that might explain the blank timeline.
I guess the question, though, for Connor is if they could put numbers next to some of the line items in here, because if there isn't, let's say we get into this and we find out we're not satisfied with the level of work that they're going to do, and we want to switch horses, so to speak.
how much do we owe? And who makes that determination? Very easily, they can hand us a bill for $14,999 and say, okay, well, we did all the work up front, even though we're limited to a contract for, 3 weeks. I just want to make sure that we're going into this eyes open.
I understand. Would it be possible, because I don't want to have to wait on this another month. We need to do it right. Don't get me wrong. If we agree that Ray Associates is the best firm to do this, can we authorize the administration to execute the contract? Can we agree? Like, is there a way we can do that so we're not waiting another month before starting the process?
No, I think we could probably say that, we agreed to entertain the proposal and not to exceed $15,500 upon review of our solicitor approval of the board. I mean, at some point, we're going to have an executive session either by phone or at a committee of the whole meeting or something to ratify the contract.
Well, I mean, there does appear to be a lot of loose issues here, that I would prefer, and I'm sure the district administration would prefer to take back to the board before final approval. I would just merely direct the district administration to obtain the actual contract form, and I'll review it in time for the committee of the whole meeting. We could present a contract in a more finalized, an actual contract in a final form for board consideration at the committee of the whole meeting.
I would think, hold on 1 second, John. I would think that in the interim, there's nothing stopping us from meeting with this group face-to-face in the district, whether it's all 9 board members, 7 board members, or it's, a collection thereof, but to have a sit-down with them and, better understand the terms of the contract, what are the things that they can start rolling up and preparing for versus, having to wait for the ink to be on the paper. I mean, there's no reason why we should be sitting on our hands for a week or 2 weeks.
If they're willing to do that.
I think they probably would.
But I would assume they would be. Yeah. And I just note that you might want to do it via video conference or teleconference just to expedite it from their end, because they do suggest that as a cost savings measure.
So rather than a motion to approve the agreement, I would just
give the administration's received the directive. I don't think any formal board action is required at this time.
So do I need to withdraw my motion?
Table.
Yeah, I guess. Sorry, Connor. We're going to table.
It's fine.
I'm trying to jump ahead of time to have this discussion.
Well, let me just ask a question, because I agree a face-to-face meeting would be good. So, Dr. Sanker, could you arrange that to have that at the district?
Absolutely.
If we can't do it face-to-face, I mean, GoToMeeting or Skype or any of these other forums are available to get all of us together, as many people as we want to participate at a specific time, and we've done this a lot in the past with other contracts where it's the board president or it's 3 or 4 other people that get together and sit down, and if not everybody can be there, those folks can at least report out to the other board members that weren't present, hey, look, these are the things that we addressed. If there's specific questions board members have about the proposal ahead of time, get them in writing to the board president or whoever they're going to be meeting with these folks, and those specific questions can be asked and answered, and we can report that back to those that were not. Can everybody hear me? Okay. So I was just saying it's probably important that in the past what we've done as a board is the board president and a couple of the board members have sat down with different parties that we're negotiating with in order to flesh out a contract. And board members that cannot be a present will typically submit questions in advance on the proposal that can be asked and answered at those meetings and reported back to them at a later time so that we can expedite this process. And there are other forums available, be it Skype or GoToMeeting or something else, where everybody can participate in the process. But there's no reason for us to sit on our hands for a week or 2 weeks while we get their contract and our solicitor has an opportunity to review the terms, and there could be a couple of iterations of that contract back and forth, quite frankly, before it's ready to be signed.
Well, I agree. So what we're asking Dr. Sanker to do is A, ask them to actually submit a contract. And,
right.
And B, Dr. Sanker, if you could set up a meeting with them either via some kind of telecommunications or in person. My understanding about Ray Associates is they have regional representatives. So
we could probably set something up this week.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. So because I agree, we don't want to wait much longer. This has been agreed by everyone that it's a priority. So
I'll take the lead on this and make the initial contact and then report back to the board.
Now, there is still a motion on the table, so I think we need to table it for the sake of parliamentary procedure.
Yeah, I make a motion to table.
Motion to table by Mr. Basil, seconded by Mrs. Bites.
Is 17 A's table?
Well, we need a vote on that.
Okay, it was 17A is being tabled. Motion by Mr. Basil. Seconded by
Mrs. Bites.
Okay.
Mrs. Bites.
Yes.
Mrs. Hamel, yes. Mr. Kurtz.
Yes.
Mr. Basil.
Yes.
And Mr. Martino.
Yes.
Motion passed.
Can I ask a quick question about the process? When we do these motions, can we motion to table and throw in a request for a roll call vote? I mean, that's not a routine. Now, we agreed to a roll call vote for routine votes, but when we make a motion on some of these, can we make a motion? Is that legal? Our motion to table and our motion includes a roll call vote.
Mrs. Bice, I think you may be mistaking roll call and voice vote. The change we made earlier was to utilize a voice vote for routine items, not a roll call. I believe what you might be asking is if we could make a motion to table by utilizing a voice vote. Is that correct?
Yes, I am, yes. Is that...
Okay, Mr. Subers might be able to weigh in that better than any of us.
I think starting next meeting, that's what we'll do. Just took the action to approve that. So I say, going forward...
No, we made the we're going to do voice votes for routine.
Well, I think a motion to table is I would consider
a routine request.
I mean, if there was an issue, it says unless requested by a board member. So if there was an issue that you specifically wanted a voice vote on, you could call for it. But if it's just a motion to table and the ayes, you ask for the ayes and there's no nays, then
okay.
It's not an issue. So that was tabled, correct?
Correct. Yes.
Item 17B, a motion to approve the settlement of claims raised by parents of a child with disabilities, providing reimbursement of educational expenses up to $15,000 in exchange for a waiver of all potential claims against the district.
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Basil, seconded by Mrs. Bites. Comments or questions?
This was handled by the solicitor for the district who handles special education. All our special education claims, and this is a negotiated settlement, and I did speak with the Mr. Warner, and he has provided an explanation to you, which I gave to you in my memo. Okay.
I have a question. I don't have attachment 6.
Oh, okay. Here it is. Sorry.
Any other questions or comments?
Oh, okay. She said it was on the computer.
No other questions or comments, Mrs. Hamel?
Motion for 17B. Motion made by Mr. Basil, seconded by Mrs. Bites. Mrs. Hamel, yes. Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Basil?
Yes.
Bites?
Yes.
And Mr. Martino?
Yes.
Motion passed.
17C, a motion to designate the Reading Eagle as the Daniel Boone Area School District newspaper of general circulation.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Basil, second by Mr. Kurtz. Questions or comments? Seeing none, Mrs. Hamel?
Motion for 17C, made by Mr. Basil, seconded by Mr. Kurtz. Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Basil?
Yes.
Bikes?
Yes.
Mrs. Hamel, yes. And Mr. Martino?
Yes.
Motion passed.
We have a motion to accept the resignation of Mrs. Hamel as a school board director, effective close of business today. Do I hear a motion?
Yes. Motion.
Motion by Mrs. Bites. Is there a second?
With regret. With regret.
I'll second it.
Seconded by Mr. Basil. Comments or questions?
I just want to thank Ms. Hamel for her service over the last few years. It's been invaluable. She's rolled up her sleeves and jumped in and really waded into a very difficult budgetary climate, and I think has brought some great ideas to the table that the board has adopted and the school board better for. And your efforts are sorely missed, and it's been a pleasure working with you, and I wish you well outside the board. And just want to let you know it was great working with you on the board, and you will be missed.
Thank you.
I'd like to just echo Mr. Basil's comments. Mrs. Hamel and I came on as freshman board members in December 2011, and I often found her expertise to be very helpful, as well as her counsel regarding some issues with the board. As it almost seems like there's a little bond between board members who come into the board together, and I really would like to thank Mrs. Hamel for her service and her help over the past few years.
Thank you for your help in orienting me to the position. It's not easy to leave, but thank you.
We need a vote.
Vote for 17B, with regrets. Motion made by Mrs. Bites, seconded by Mr. Basil. Mr. Basil?
No.
No. Mrs. Bites?
Yes.
Mrs. Hamel? Yes. Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
And Mr. Martino?
Yes.
Motion passed.
Can I ask, have we gotten 3 no votes? Would she have to stay?
I don't know. I guess I'm actually hoping. I was hoping.
If you have some regrets there, we're still accepting letter of intent.
Item 17E, the resignation of Mr. McLaughlin.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Mr. Basil, seconded by Mrs. Bites.
Roll call. 17E, motion made by Mr. Basil, seconded by Mrs. Bites. Mrs. Bites?
Yes.
Mrs. Hamel, yes. Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Basil?
Yes.
And Mr. Martino?
Yes.
Motion passed.
There's item 17F is a motion to appoint someone as the BCTC alternate representative, with everyone missing tonight and 2 board members not yet appointed. I don't have a name to suggest for item F or G.
Yeah, I would say we just pass on those until we have some more people here.
I move we table items F and G.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Kurtz to table items F and G, 17F and G, and seconded by Mr. Basil. Comments or questions? Mrs. Hamel?
The motion for 17F and G to be tabled. Motion made by Mr. Kurtz, seconded by Mr. Basil. Mrs. Hamel, yes. Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Basil?
Yes.
Mrs. Bites?
Yes.
And Mr. Martino?
Yes.
Motion passed.
Item 17H, A motion to approve the revised school board committees as presented by the school board president. So let me give you what the school board president has revised. Mrs. Twardowski has agreed to chair the facilities committee. Mr. Basil has agreed to chair the transportation committee. We require replacements for Ms. Hamill and or Mr. McLaughlin on the facilities committee, and I say and or because we have two members, so we need at least one more, but no more than two. We require replacements for Ms. Hamill and Mr. McLaughlin on the transportation committee. Unless we have any volunteers, I intended to wait until our new board members are selected to nominate anybody for these vacancies, unless there's an objection or somebody wants to volunteer.
I was just going to point out to them, the rest of the board members, you know, as a sole member of the transportation committee at this point, I don't want to wait a month to get started on having discussions with our transportation partners. And so what I suggested to Mr. Martino, as board president, you know, act as a de facto board member, committee member, to allow, we need at least two committee members to have a meeting, and that would enable us to at least begin those discussions with our transportation providers. And if there's no objections to that, I just want to make sure that was transparent to the rest of the board.
And I've agreed to do that. I think there is another transportation committee member, though.
I think it's just me.
I don't have it with me. If Mrs. Kramer has it, we could.
According to the website, it's Mr. McLaughlin, Mr. Basil, Mrs. Hamill, and Ms. Twardowski.
Oh, okay.
I thought there was another one, so it is Ms. Twardowski.
Well, you know she was on. All right. You're not welcome. We'll take care of that. Thank you.
And lastly, it seems as if, and somebody's going to need to explain this to me, it seems as if the negotiations committee and the meet and discuss committee have redundant responsibilities. And therefore, and we have vacancies on both, and I propose that we merge the two committees, which would now be composed of Mr. Rathgeb as chair, Mr. Basil, Mrs. Bites, and Ms. Twardowski. And that would fill the positions on the merged committee.
Yeah, I mean, the only reason why we had split them in the past was certain board members had conflicts of interest that would prohibit them from sitting in both seats.
Any other comments on my suggestion?
I make a motion that we, oh wait, are we moving, are these all your suggestions? We're going to move an item H?
Yes.
Okay. Are you done listing them? Because I'll make the motion.
I'm done listing them, yes.
Okay. I move item 17H.
Second.
Item 17H moved by Mr. Kurtz, seconded by Mrs. Bites.
Motion for 17H as presented. Motion made by Mr. Kurtz, seconded by Mrs. Bites. Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Basil?
Yes.
Mrs. Bites?
Yes.
Mrs. Hamill, yes. And Mr. Martino?
Yes.
Motion passed.
Mr. Martino, I have two other items under new business I'd like to discuss. The first item is the position of board secretary. I know, Mrs. Hamill, we accepted her resignation as a director. However, I do believe we also need to accept her resignation as board secretary because there's not a requirement that you have to necessarily be on the board to be the board secretary. So if we don't accept that, I believe she continues to be secretary even though she's no longer a director. I believe that's my understanding.
That's a possibility, so...
I'm pretty sure when I wrote the email that I knew that was an issue, and I put in, I thought, board, director, and secretary.
Yeah, Yes, Mrs. Hamel, I read that in your email, but I'm looking at the motion, and on the agenda, the motion is to accept the resignation of Monica Hamel, school board director, effective January 17, 2014. So we never accepted the secretary part.
Okay, well, what you could do is we had a prior discussion regarding the possibility of Mr. Basil filling that position. We can make a, you know, I'm suggesting a motion to accept the resignation of Mrs. Hamel as board secretary and the appointment of Mr. Basil to fill that vacancy until that term expires.
I will move. So moved.
Is there a second? Is there a second? Motion to accept the resignation of Mrs. Hamel as board secretary and appoint Mr. Basil as the board secretary. Moved by Mr. Kurtz, seconded by Mr. Basil. Comments or questions? It would be 17I, yes.
The motion for 17I was made by Mr. Kurtz, seconded by Mr. Basil. Mr. Basil?
Yes.
Mrs. Bites?
Yes.
Mrs. Hamel, yes. Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
And Mr. Martino?
Yes.
Motion passed.
I have one other item. I know at a reorganization meeting, I brought up for the board the President's Volunteer Service Award, which would be a great way to honor our volunteers at no cost to the district. I was wondering if Dr. Sanker could provide an update on where that approval process stands with the administration and if we need to make a formal motion to put that in action. I thought we approved it by pretty much consenting to it. However, I don't know if there's been any action taken. So, Dr. Sanker, can you please provide an update?
I wanted to look at a committee or an organization affiliated with the district to possibly take that on as one of their tasks that they do regularly, because most of the volunteers come out of the elementary level, and I have to put that into, I have to take the next step, and with all the delays and closings that we've had and holidays, I haven't had a chance to do that yet, but I still have.
Well, I'd like to make a motion that we authorize somebody in the administration to fill out the approval form to become a partner. It's not anything too in-depth. I'm on the website. I've looked at the website, and I'd like to get this moving, and I don't want it to just be stagnating. It's a great idea, I think, and it should be free of controversy. So if we could just deputize somebody in the administration, I would like to move that we become a partner with the President's Volunteer Service Award at no cost to the district.
Hey, Connor, I'm sorry, Mr. Kurtz, would it be possible for you to share a link? I don't think I've seen anything.
Sure.
Other than you mentioning it in December, I haven't seen anything about this. I thought you were going to send something around to the board.
Oh, I'd be happy to send a link. I will do it after the meeting. Would we prefer... I guess there's no hurry to do this. We could wait till the next meeting. But again, I'm irritated. I'm speaking just as a board member about how slow things seem to operate. And this is something that could be done very quickly. But if we prefer, could wait.
Mr. Kurtz, let me just say, I mean, I would like to just get a little bit more information about this so we as a board are aware of what we're getting involved in. And are there any additional costs to this? Are there any administrative responsibilities that need to be tied up with this? I mean, I don't know anything about it. I think it's a good idea, but I think we should, if you could send us that information, I don't see any reason why, as a board, we can't review
that. We need to do the diligence on that.
And then we could talk about it at the next meeting, and we can keep it on the agenda as something, as a point of discussion, so it doesn't get lost from 1 month to the next.
And Mr. Kurtz, seriously, as far as slow-moving process, I don't totally disagree, but I think it's incumbent on all of us then to provide the information right up front and then ask that it be placed on the agenda so we can discuss it and vote on it.
Okay. All right. Well, I'd like to vote at the next meeting, so I will send the information, and I'd ask the board members, please check it out.
Thank you, Connor.
Any other comments or questions? Presentations by the public on any issue?
of paper and having some resumes come in. We're in dire straits here. Do we really need to be throwing $15,000 out of our budget for this?
Well, I think part of the effort of this is going to be to help qualify those candidates, make sure that those ads are placed in all the appropriate places. We also have resources that we don't have readily available to go out and seek candidates that meet our qualifications. So, you know, the last time we engaged in this type of process, Mr. Templin, we had hired, I keep getting it, it's not PAS, but it was PARS.
PARS.
PARS. Mm-hmm. And to assist us with that, I believe the cost was over $8,000 to bring viable candidates to the board and help us with the interviewing process and the selection of a candidate. In terms of finding a CEO for a $50 million organization, my personal opinion is $15,000 is the minimum cost to the school district.
Mr. Templin, let me just add to that. We could put an ad in the paper and just get whatever local candidates happen to see that. I would like to have us have a shot at the best available candidate, and I think this is a vehicle that we can do that.
We can't get papers like the New York Times, Philadelphia paper, whatever, all around our adjacent states, and put them in ourselves and expedite this amount of money. I mean, I don't know. It's just mind-boggling to think we're putting money out to spend more money. And anyway. On the 16th, about the voice over the roll call, I mean, that's fine, but could at least I or yay or put a hand up so the public can see who is voting for and against these?
That's what a voice vote is, Mr. Templin. All those in favor, Mr. Templin, that's what a voice vote is. All those in favor say aye, all those opposed, nay. If there's no nays, then you know everybody voted aye.
Hey, did you see me vote? That's what I'm saying. Did I see who's saying nays? Who's saying ayes? That's all I mean, you know. That's all I want.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Can we raise our hands?
Yeah, absolutely.
I like that idea.
We've done it in the past. Yeah, we've done that in the past.
I'd just like to add that an executive search is generally expensive process, and to put advertisements in the screening process that they're providing, $15,000. I too am reluctant to spend on the district money, but I'll address
Mr. Hankel.
We are preliminarily looking at June the 6th. That has been our goal.
That's Friday,
June the 6th. The idea being family will be coming in for the weekend and would be best for them.
The other part of his question was location. The other part of his question was location.
Location, we had hoped to continue one in Alvernia.
Four, and
hopefully two are going to go to five. because they did some construction at Elbert.
Have we put a deposit down?
Excuse me?
Did we already put a deposit to hold the space?
No, it's just been simply a verbal commitment.
Okay.
Mr. Smith, I had asked the same question. I was thinking in terms of cost. And the answer I got was, A, weather-related, and B, I'm told the sound system is not the best. Is that correct, Mr. Hankel?
Outside?
Yes. At our stadium.
Any outside venue, unless you have a fantastic sound system, personally possible to hear. I was only a spectator at the outside graduation.
I can tell you from sitting up there, one particular graduation we had, the valedictorian was up speaking, and on the far side of the field, people were shouting at her as she was giving her speech, "We can't hear you, we can't hear you." And it was very disruptive for her and you know, disconcerting. I thought that the venue served very well at Alvernia last year. It was a much closer experience, I think. So as a parent, I mean, you're literally, they were feet from their children as opposed to 100, 200 yards away. I don't know. I thought it was a good experience. It would be nice to have it out on our field if there was some way that we could increase that intimate experience, but I'm not sure how we replicate that. I think last year we decided as a board that regardless of whether it was at our field or at Alvernia, we wanted to put down the deposit money and reserve that space so it was an option. And pending feedback from the public on the experience there, so.
Yeah, but you've got the weather permit.
A couple concerns around the amount of change within the board. We lost X amount of members, superintendent, president, a lot of change at once. Speaking for myself, I just have concerns on the continuity, what plans we have to get everybody together to mesh, to develop some type of rapport with the public. Any plans, or we just bring it full small and hopefully it works out?
Well, as far as you address that, I mean, let me just, I have some thoughts on this. So one, whoever was president last year, me, hasn't gone anywhere, I'm still here. And, you know, Mr. Martino is the board president now, and whatever information that I can provide to the new board members, you know, we have those conversations, procedure or history or anything of that nature. So I don't think you've lost any continuity in terms of the board history, as it were. We still have a lot of people in our administration who have been here through the good times and the bad times in one capacity or another. So I think there's still that history there. In terms of board members exiting and versus staying, everybody, my personal opinion is everybody does what's in their best interest at the time, and this is a very demanding job. It takes more than 16 or 20 hours a month, which is the average reported by BASMA. There are some weeks I spend 20 hours just focused on Danny Boone issues. So, you know, for someone who needs to spend more time with their family or with their career, those things come first. And so I don't begrudge anyone for stepping off the board to address those items. And if they feel that they can't participate to the level they want to, then if they want to get off and let somebody else step into their shoes who can put in 100%, then I welcome that input. In terms of our business manager position being open, I'm going to have to give a shout out to Mr. Boyer over there. In the 6 years that I've been here, he has done more to help this school district with its finances, with the business office and procedures than our previous two business managers combined. He's a very talented man. He knows what he's doing when it comes to the district finances. We are looking for someone with some experience to fill that role, but Mr. Boyer is one of our considerations, or has been one of our considerations in the past for that post. In the interim, we've been very fortunate to have two very experienced men from other school districts sit in and mentor Mr. Boyer over the last 6 months and provide their insights and different methodologies for analyzing the finances of the school district, and we've benefited immensely from that. And we will go forward and continue to look for business managers. We spent last year a period of 4 or 5 months interviewing business managers and potential candidates for that post and found them lacking. So again, like the superintendent, we want to make sure that the person that is there is the best suited candidate for that position and will help further the school district get to the next level. I think we have to be careful in who we choose because the law has changed regarding hiring of candidates for these positions, whether it's superintendent or business manager. People are looking for 3-year contracts. And so you don't want to pick the wrong candidate and have that person there for 3 years. And, you know, we have a lot of new board members that came on in December. I think as we got closer to that date and we were unsuccessful in finding candidates that met the requirements of the prior board, we deferred to allow the new board members to participate in the process because we thought it was very important that the new board members that are sitting here choose the person that they're going to be working with for the next 4 years. And I'm confident that the people that are in place now can handle any issue that comes up in the school district going forward. I sat on boards where we had board members that were board members in name only. They would leave in the middle of a meeting to go watch a football game or wouldn't participate in committees and other things, and the board functioned and got the business of the school district done. You have a group of people here that are diving in. And I say that in the best way. I mean, these new board members have been very aggressive in terms of getting involved as much as they possibly can in the mechanics of being a board member, and I think it's a wonderful thing. I'm not in the least bit worried that, in terms of continuity and leadership and any of those issues. We've got the people in place to help us, and we're looking to get additional participants in this school district that can help take us to the next level. And we're going to be aggressive in that search.
Mr. Smith, let me just add briefly that the new board members, especially so many coming on at once, there are procedural things that we do need to learn. I don't think you were at the last meeting, the committee, the whole meeting, where I asked everybody to rise for the national anthem. There are semantics and procedures we do need to get a grasp on. As far as the issues, believe me, we have spent considerable amount of time in the past month and a half reading and discussing, and we have enough of a rapport with the more experienced board members that we can talk. We don't always agree, but we can talk, and the communications, I think, are good in that respect. And hopefully the two board members that we're going to add will have the same relationship that these 7 people remaining now have.
But this is not going to happen without some serious work.
budget and getting things under control. And I don't envy your position at all. I seriously don't. It's a very difficult position. You're not, you're kind of between a rock and a hard place. Bad past board decisions, which are water under the bridge, we can't do anything about, and the economy and everything that's going on right now. I'm not a fan of a tax increase. You know, my family, that would hurt, okay? And I know that I don't stand alone when it comes to that. There are many families who are worse off than I am. I've got two in college and another one in a year and a half. So, you know, there are people who are far worse off than I am. If it comes down to that, though, do not increase taxes without doing some other work. There's got to be other sources of revenue. And, you know, I think of the contractual partners. I know there was a lot of discussion and a lot of heated debate and everything over that last year. I hope that that has not just been completely tabled. I hope you all will continue to work with and look to them for their help, because I know that, I'm pretty sure in my heart, that they really want to get that, and they really want to help. Also, Mrs. Hamill had some awesome ideas last year about some things that we could do to raise some revenue, some different things that she presented at one of the other committee meetings, and then she presented here, and I haven't heard anything about that. And the last thing I think I heard was that it was kind of pushed over to the foundation, but I haven't heard anything about how it's going with that. I would really be interested to know if any of those ideas have been explored any further than all the work that she did. I know she put a tremendous amount of effort into that.
Mrs. Snyder, I need to ask you to wrap up because you're
I'm sorry.
Well past the 3 minutes. Let me just address the last part of what you said. The ideas, and Mrs. Hamill did a tremendous amount of work last year, and those items that she was working on are not dead. There is still a revenue enhancement committee. It hasn't met yet this year, but it will, and we do intend to look at all facets of the budget before making any determination.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Any other public comment? Seeing none, is there a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Basil, second by Mr. Kurtz. Thank you.
One of my many skills.
Which one was that?
Stress, I take care of it. I was a little disappointed when